In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask your pardon for my sins, and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly a sound came from heaven like the rush of a mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues as of fire, distributed and resting on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak in other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. The account of the Acts of the Apostles, St. Luke, of what we're celebrating today is really magnificent. And as always, we begin our meditation understanding the literal sense of the sacred text. Pentecost was one of the three major feasts of the Jews, for which Israelites from all over Palestine and even from the diaspora went to Jerusalem to worship in the temple. It was originally a harvest feast, but it had acquired religious meaning as a commemoration of the promulgation of the law given to Moses by God in the Sinai. It was celebrated after 7 weeks, 49 days had passed since the Passover. That means on the 50th day after the Passover. That's why it's called Pentecost. In the Christian tradition, the material harvest celebrated by the Jews has become a symbol of the spiritual harvest that the apostles and the early Christians would begin to enjoy in abundance is starting that day of Pentecost. They were all together in one place. Although the Acts was not explicit on who this they were, the account of the preceding days leading to the Ascension makes us think that the place was the upper room, the same place that Christ had celebrated the Last Supper in. And the people referred to were the apostles in the first place, but also some of our Lord's relatives and the holy women, all around the Blessed Virgin Mary. This constituted, shall we say, the human substrate of the church. The hierarchy, the apostles, the faithful, our Lord's brethren and the holy women, around the Blessed Virgin. The church, ecclesia in Latin, iglesia in Spanish, is not composed of people who have come together to form an association. The Greek ecclesia, which comes from the verb ekklesein, which means to convoke, gives the idea that the church is like an assembly that had been convoked. An assembly of the faithful who do not assemble themselves, but rather are called together by God, who give them the faith. That's why from the ground up, the church is imminently divine. It's divine in its origin. It's divine in its constitution, composed of the children of God. And it's divine in its provision. It's managed by God. We had considered one of these days how if the Spirit of God was moving over the waters of creation, those inert waters of the earth, one could even think of space and all the celestial bodies, if God would supervise that, manage it. And at the end of the day, what are they? They're inanimate. What more? Human beings who are made to his image, who are elevated to his likeness because of the Spirit of God that was breathed into them. And so therefore, who are his beloved children? That is why, from the ground up, as I said, the church is eminently divine. It is of Trinitarian design. What a moving image of the church. The tableau of Pentecost Sunday gives us. Faithful around their bishops and all around our leading. St. Paul VI explained this point very well on Pentecost Sunday in 1969. When he addressed the crowd saying, "Today, as you know, the church was fully born through the breath of Christ, the Holy Spirit. And in the church was born the word, the witness to and promulgation of salvation in the risen Jesus. And in him who listens to this promulgation is born faith, and with faith a new life, an awareness of the Christian vocation and the ability to hear that calling and to follow it by living a genuinely human life. Indeed, a life which is not only human, but holy. And to make this divine intervention effective, today was born the apostolate, the priesthood, the ministry of the Spirit, the calling to unity, fraternity, and peace." A sound came from heaven. We read, like the rush of a mighty wind, and it filled the house where they were. And there appeared to them tongues of fire settling on top of each one of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. The human substrate alone would not make the church. In much the same way that the physical parts of the body would not make a human person. The Holy Spirit animates that assembly of people, just as a soul animates the body of a human person. On that Pentecost Sunday, the Church of Christ began to exist. Up to that moment, it was in gestation, it was in preparation. But on Pentecost Sunday, it existed in its fullness. And that's the reason why the church shall prevail over any challenge until the end of time. As our Lord promised in Caesarea Philippi, the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Why? Because of this indwelling, because of this animation, because of this living principle, which is the Spirit of God himself. This is also the reason why whatever happens in the history of the church is ultimately good. Because the Holy Spirit always moves the church in the right direction. Despite what, humanly speaking, may appear like momentary missteps. Those sex scandals in the state, those cases of less than saintly popes in the Middle Ages, especially in the Renaissance. All of these, every now and then, conspiracy theories, one of those are anecdotes in the life of an institution that is animated by the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit always moves the church in the right direction in order for it to accomplish what it was designed to do, which is to be Christ's presence in human history up to the end of time. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. This final verse has at times been misunderstood to mean speaking in strange tongues, making such behavior a sign even of the presence of the Paraclete. The account of St. Luke clarifies the matter for us when he says, Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven staying in Jerusalem. At this sound, they gathered in a large crowd, but they were bewildered because each one heard them, the apostles, speaking in his own language. And they were amazed and wondered, saying, "Are not all these people who are speaking Galileans?" People knew that the apostles were from Galilee. "And how is it that we hear each of us in his own native language? Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians. We hear them telling in our own tongue the mighty works of God." Clearly, the apostles were not speaking in strange tongues, much less in gibberish, but rather in the language of each of their listeners, because the aim was to proclaim the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ, not to cause amazement, much less consternation because of the incomprehensibility of their words. Well, in our case, we too are called to proclaim the good news by making ourselves intelligible to our listeners. The truth, St. John Paul II used to say, is of itself attractive, but it is often masked by half-truths, prejudices, or irrelevant details. Our task in the apostolate of good doctrine is to reveal the truth by drawing aside the falsehoods that veil it, and not to further confuse our listeners with our abstruse discourse, much less if the only purpose is novelty. Because sometimes you hear people, some theologian or some priest normally, who wants to dazzle his audience by saying something which is strange, to be interesting. But rather than clarify matters, it just causes problems. Because even if sometimes those things, those affirmations may be defensible theologically, philosophically, they can only be done in an audience of philosophers and theologians, not for everyone. Because without the proper equipment of philosophy and theology, such affirmations would be risque, so to speak. That's what happens, for example, when, I don't know, some person were to say that morality is like this and like that. This is what the Holy Spirit had come to do, to complete the revelation brought about by Jesus Christ. And the gospel reading taken from St. John's account of the Last Supper makes this clear. When St. John writes, "Jesus said to his disciples, 'When the Counselor comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, he will bear witness to me. And you also are witnesses, because you have been with me from the beginning.'" What is our Lord saying there? Despite all the preparation that he had given them, despite the additional explanations after the resurrection, before he ascended to heaven, our Lord knew that the supernatural truths that he had revealed to them still needs, shall we say, further explanation. And even more important than that, further crystallization or confirmation in their intellects and in their hearts. And that would be the job of the Paraclete. That would be the job of the Holy Spirit. The faith is supernatural. Can you imagine how supernatural it is for us to affirm that there are three persons in one God, three in one? And yet we don't have any problem with that. Try explaining that to a pagan. Try explaining that to somebody who is not a Christian, and you will see how he will look perplexed. Why? Because he doesn't have the faith. You accept it, abide by it because you have the faith. Take away that faith, take away that gift of the Holy Spirit, and all of these things will seem abstruse or definitely beyond reason. Not contradictory, but beyond it. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. He enables the faithful to understand the mysteries of our faith. That is why even the work of theology needs to be done in the bosom of the Paraclete, outside of which it becomes vain knowledge and outright heresy. Without faith, it is impossible to do real theology. Thus concludes our Lord's discourse on this point in the Last Supper, when he said, "I have much more to tell you, but you cannot bear it now. But when he comes, the Spirit of truth, he will guide you to all truth. He will not speak on his own, but he will speak what he hears and will declare to you the things that are coming. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the heart of your faithful and enkindle in them the fire of your love." Because at the end of the day, it's not a question of being bright or, you know, philosophically prepared or being a great theologian. The mysteries of our faith are mysteries. And we accept them because we want to. We accept them because we love to. We will to. That's how faith works. The evidence of faith is not physical certainty. It's not something that the intellect is helpless in front of. That's the reason why we always have a choice. If we choose not to believe, we can. If we choose to deny revelation, we can. But if we choose to accept it, we also can, and everything becomes clear. This is the kind of shall we say, clarity of doctrine. This is the kind of even elevated theology that very simple souls in the history of the church have come up with. Think, for example, of the depth of understanding of the Holy Spirit by that simple seamstress, Javiera del Valle. Or think of the theology of divine filiation and spiritual childhood that young nun, Saint Therese of Lisieux, came up with that qualified her to be a doctor of the church. What formation, what philosophical and theological formation did she have before that? Nothing. It's just that she was like a sponge, loving the will of God, wanting to understand him, and God explained things to him, to her rather. At times, we hear of theologians who defend positions contrary to the magisterium of the church, proposing them as equally valid options. A concrete example is the teaching of some theologians, even in some of our so-called Catholic universities, regarding the morality of contraception, and lately of same-sex unions. Just last week, for example, more than 100 priests in various dioceses in Germany blessed same-sex unions, defying a Vatican ban on such blessings issued last March with the approval of the Pope. While this is the approval of the Pope banning it, that is to say, not the approval of the Pope to make the blessing of same-sex unions. So while this is just the latest of such acts of departure from the unity of doctrine and discipline in the church that is happening in Germany, it remains a cause for sorrow and a motive for atonement for all the faithful children of the church. On the other hand, the explanation of such doctrinal aberrations is quite simple. Without faith, there can be no orthodoxy. The converse is also true. When there's faith, when there's piety, even doctrinal deviations are soon corrected. There would be honest mistakes. Ultimately, the reason is what St. John Paul II already said decades ago, that while there are many errors, there is only one truth. And the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. Is the shortcut towards that truth. piety has led simple and humble souls to the deepest truths. We need to be pious. We need to be humble. And very important, we need to be prompt, meaning to say, without any hidden agenda, without any provision, because many times doctrinal errors are there because of a moral position that someone has unfortunately gotten attached to. I will remember that affirmation of a priest that I love so much, who I love so much, was the priest of the first center of Opus Dei I went to as a college student. When he surprised us, a bunch of young men, in a doctrine class and said, you know, many, or not all, of the problems of faith that you find in campus, he was referring to UP Diliman. He was referring to the problems that were common that then, in the early 70s, and belonged to the first quarter storm. And then he said that many of the problems of faith, many of the problems of philosophy and theology that these people are saying are really problems of chastity. In other words, what they're suffering from are attachments to certain immoral practices, which they are so ashamed to bring back to confession again and again, until one day they just rationalize that maybe it's not a sin, or maybe one doesn't need to go to confession and one can confess directly to God. That seems the reason for all the other sacraments is the same reason why confession is there. Put that in doubt and you'll have to brush aside the others also. And before you know it, what you have is a mental diarrhea of doctrine or false doctrines. This is what happens. And what has happened there, what failed there, is the lack of intellectual honesty, which is the biggest obstacle to the action of the paraclete in the soul. Because the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is the Spirit of truth. So therefore, when someone is not interested in the truth, when someone is rather trying to justify, rationalize a weakness, a position, then he can see. He refuses to see. That's the reason for all these justifications of the LGBT agenda. That's the reason for all the justifications of contraception or of divorce, or can you imagine something as heinous as abortion? Today's solemnity invites us to strive for a deeper knowledge and closer relationship with the Holy Spirit. He is the consubstantial mutual love of the Father for the Son and the Son for the Father. Is also the gift of God himself, because love is the gift of self. The Holy Spirit is the principle of the supernatural life in man, what enables us to know and love the Son to the point of identification with him, and because of that, to know and love the Father as the Son knows and loves him. Unfortunately, for many people, the Holy Spirit is, as St. Jose Maria Escrivá used to say, the great unknown. It's easy enough to know Jesus Christ. He's there in the gospel. It's a little bit more difficult, but still accessible, to think of God the Father. We pray to him every day, our Father who art in heaven. It's not very understandable that God is a loving Father because of our own experience with our own human Father. But the Holy Spirit, a little bit more abstract for most people. What we need to remember is, he may seem abstract, but it's actually the first principle for all this ability of ours to believe in Jesus Christ, to love Jesus Christ, to follow Jesus Christ, and because of that, to be able to address God the Father as Jesus Christ addresses him, as Father, Abba, Pater. The reason why we can do all of these things is because of the activity of the Paraclete in our soul. But just as you normally can taste your tongue, because you taste with it, or smell your nose because you smell with it. Or feel your fingertips because they're the ones that feel. Unless you concentrate and you reflect, and maybe you can just make it to taste your tongue or smell your own nose and definitely feel your own fingertips. We need to make an effort to be aware of the Holy Spirit. But if we do make that effort and we do become sensitive to the Holy Spirit, then we make a quantum leap in our interior life. Because instead of the principle just acting without our being too aware of him, we become aware of him, and so therefore all his actuations would become for us very, very clear, or not to say almost palpable. And that kind of response, that kind of promptness, that kind of devotion to the paraclete in our soul leads us to be also prompt to whatever the Father tells us, whatever Jesus Christ tells us. And that is interior life. Just like a car, you have an engine, but that engine is connected to the wheels through what is known as the drive train. Before, those drive trains pass through a transmission, the huge gadget there, that really, depending on how good the transmission was, kind of made the power of the car a little bit distant from the wheels. It was a step away. Nowadays, with the kind of engines we have, and instead of having a drive train going to the rear wheels, their front wheel drives, then the effect of the motor is felt immediately by the wheels. It's closer. Something like that ought to happen in our interior life, if we're sensitive, if we have a personal relationship with the Holy Spirit, that his inspirations will become immediate. His motions will also become immediate. And then we start really acting like children of God. That our actions, our reactions, our thoughts, our feet will be constantly a reflection of his initiatives in our soul. And that is the maturity of the interior life. That's the maturity of the Christian life. When one attains that, one can almost say he's just a step short of heaven. And he starts living a heavenly existence. If he dies that way, then he just segues to an eternity of heaven. That is the goal of Christian life. We have to end. We can end with some words also from St. Paul the Sixth. When referring to Our Lady, he said, "Mary, who conceived Christ by the work of the Holy Spirit, the love of the living God, presides over the birth of the church on the day of Pentecost, when the same Holy Spirit comes down on the disciples and gives life to the mystical body of Christians in unity and charity." We have a few minutes left to end the prayer.